what you see. Nothing? No, you don't see anything? You see God? Awesome, awesome, awesome. I just lost my whole children's time with that. Thanks. So you guys see nothing with your eyes shut. Well, today's a scripture lesson. We're going to hear from Acts a little later on. We're going to hear how Saul was struck blind. We are going to be hearing about how he didn't see. But then when he was able to see, he saw more than just opening our eyes and seeing the congregation out there and the beautiful colors. He was able to see God spiritually, but in his blindness is where he met God. So I want all of you to bow your heads with me and think about this prayer, and I invite you all to pray it. Almighty God, help us all to see you in all things. Amen. Thank you. I'll see you next week. Yes, and for some of the children that were not here last week, everybody is welcome to go to Children's Church. They are going to have breakfast up there and other things.
Okay, kids are getting ready to go there. The acolytes are gathered around the Mission Penny churches, and this is going to our agape fund this month. And that's just to help specific area, person, or family in need as the need arises. Announcements this week. There's three different Bible studies going on. We've started. If you're interested in those, you can find out a little more about them in the bulletin. Operation Soup Line's coming up. And I'm sure that Benny Robbins will have tickets. Benny's here today or not. He's always the one to see about tickets to the Operation Soup Line. Pie donations are needed. We've been asked to supply 80 pies this year. So if you are a pie baker and would like to participate, well, you can read the directions here and get on to that. If you're on a committee, this church this year, we're having a all-committee meeting on Sunday, January 28th, Fellowship Hall at 11 a.m. Kevin Dish dinner will be going on, and we'll kick off our committees for the year. So if you're a committee, please attend that so the chairman can find out who's on their committee. And if they don't have a chair, they might elect you one. So come and defend yourself. The other thing I'd like to draw your attention to, the calendar on the other side of the bulletin, you'll notice next Saturday is we've got the NCCC basketball games listed. We have quite a few of the student athletes that come help with the wants. And the activities planning committee felt like this might be a way that we can show some appreciation to them and show our support by going to their ball game. So if you'd like to go to an NCC basketball game, we're going to try to get a group together to go be there. The game starts at 4 p.m. on Saturday. So just keep that in mind. Like I said, we've got quite a few of the student athletes to help us, and we thought, well, this might be a way that we can show our appreciation and support to them later on as the baseball and softball seasons get started. I know we've got several of the kids here in that sport. So like I say, we'll try to keep you posted on some of those so we can, you know, have some church support for them, because they do come out and help us quite a bit. So, are there any other announcements at this point? Ms. Cindy.
Well, I have a really cool story, and I should probably share it for joys and concerns, but with the amount of kids, I think I better get upstairs. So, in youth group, we're doing Faith in Action, James, the book of James, Faith in Action. And so, this helped me wrap my mind about all the things that would have been in line for this whole story to take place. So, Sunday night, I showed the video, and we have it on our Facebook page. If you haven't seen it, it's Change in Action. It's about a homeless guy who's got less than a dollar and how he changed four or five people's lives with that little amount of money. So we broke up into groups, the high school and the middle school, and I had told my leaders, I know you're busy, so I'll bring all the supplies you need, and I'll leave them in your rooms. So I brought magazines and newspapers from home, and I kind of rolled my eyes when I was thinking about bringing the newspapers from home, because I'm like, what in Chanute, Kansas is going to depict widows and orphans, because that was part of the lesson. And so that being said, we break up into groups, and then Tanya, because I had showed that movie, Tanya Caldwell, had told this story about she had went through the drive-thru at McDonald's, and she said, I hate to say this, but the girl knows me, not by name, but because I'm there all the time. And she says, I never have cash, never, ever have cash in my wallet. And so she was bantering back and forth with the girl, and somebody had, she had, already done an order and was getting ready to move on, and then the car behind her placed the order, and of course the girl repeated it back and got it wrong, and the car in the back yelled at her, and she's like, oh my gosh, my day's been going like this all day long. And so Tanya's like, oh, it'll get better, and so she drove up to the second window. Well, between the first and the second window, she said, God laid it on my heart that I needed to give that $50 to that girl at the first window. So she gets her stuff, pulls around, parks, walks over the thing. I mean, that takes some effort to do that. And knocks on the window and says, she didn't say, I'm going to give you this. She said, God's laying it on my heart that I need to give you this $50. And she reached out and she grabbed her and hugged her and kissed her and said, girl, you have no idea. And so then Tanya said to the kids, the very next day, Jeff won $50 gift certificate card at Cardinal in a drawing. And that's pretty cool. And that could have been the end of the story. But this is where God comes in. So she's telling me the story after youth group, and one of the girls, her name's Sabri, doesn't get to come to youth group anymore because she has traveling volleyball. Well, she happened to get this newspaper that I brought from home, and in it, she cut out a picture of a girl in the Smiles column. It wasn't like this girl was on the front page for basketball or anything else. It was just a little picture in the Smiles column. And so they had to bring it up and say how they were widows or orphans and how they were going to help them. And she said she had met this girl through the Carly Bible study out at Safari, and that every time they went out there, this particular girl sought Sabri out and asked her to pray for her. That's pretty amazing. So I said, well, gosh. And then, of course, all the kids are gone. This is just me and Tanya and Sky and Jake and Caitlin. And I said, well, maybe that's really a sign that we need to invite her to youth group. And so they're like, yeah, we need to do that. So Tanya takes the picture and shows it to Caitlin. And Caitlin's like, man, I think she's a sixth grader. So she hands the picture to Jake, and Jake says, yeah, that girl's in my grade. She's the daughter of the lady that you helped at McDonald's. God's good.
Okay, any other announcements? Gonna top that?
There will be no kids choir this week only. We'll start again next week.
Okay, no kids choir this week only. So, are there any other announcements?
We got one.
Hey, you gotta say a thank you. Whoever put up the Awana sign, whoever put it up there, thank you.
Hey, Awana sign. So I'm thanking you for that. Another thing we need to thank, I see Don McGriddle sitting here. Don was one of three or four people from our church that helped my wife out Friday. She had a career day in a degree and went very successfully. Had about 40 presenters to talk to all the high school kids about different careers. And Don and Sandy Grove and Jeff Caldwell, I know, are all members of her church that she hit up and donated a morning of their time to come down and talk to the kids. So I really want to thank them for doing that. And it made her life a whole lot easier when the presenters say, yeah, we really want to do that. So appreciate that, guys. Is there any other announcements this morning? If not, stand up and pass the peace. I say if you want a fist bump or whatever, peace out.
The time has come to be reborn. The kingdom is right here. tell a short story while the choir is getting into place here. Madison and I traveled to Pittsburgh yesterday to visit my grandpa who's on his deathbed. And that's really okay, because since he fell in his garage 2 years ago and laid there for 3 days, he wasn't supposed to live more than 6 months. But here it is, it's been 2 years. So he's come down with pneumonia and flu, and he's on his deathbed. So we went to see him, he got to meet Madison, and that brought one of the biggest smiles to his face. It was really cool. My grandpa is Dr. Ron Albright. Some of you may know him. He's an orthodontist. He was an orthodontist in Pittsburgh. He's worked on many of your guys' mouths. And I didn't know it either, but Ernie's brother was friends with him and got to use my grandpa's cabin several times. They hung out together. Anyways, my grandpa was a very godly man. We know where he is going. And when we arrived there yesterday, there was friends there from his church, and they were singing. And Madison took a really cool picture of me holding my grandpa's hand. It's just our hands. Some of you saw that. And my aunt said, "This picture, exclamation point, I see and feel the love, joy, and worship that was in that room. I hear lifetime friends and family singing, what a day that will be when my Jesus I will see." That just happens to be the song we're singing today. And that happened, that had nothing to do with me, because I wasn't even at practice Wednesday, because I was still working for the post office. So I don't know if that's a God thing or what, but This song is for my grandpa, and I hope for each and every one of you that you know where you're going when you're laying on your deathbed. I hope you have a smile on your face.
It's funny, I know when Terry's commented several times when she's done funerals, that she always was kind of, when she goes to pick the music for funeral, it's kind of see what floats. And invariably, it works. I mean, we had family friends, dad passed away. She played for here a couple weeks ago, and she was practicing home, developing some kind of jazzy stuff with Cecil, and the solos that they picked for the funeral that she didn't know at the time, because they were using recordings, and just went right along with it. So, you know, just, it works. That's all there is to it. Anybody have any joys or concerns they'd like to share this morning? We've got several folks on the back of the bulletin. Need to keep in our prayers. That list is ever changing. What's the update on Christian?
Christian is home. There's a lot of testing. They found brain bleeds indicative of possible trauma, but they do not know what type at this point. It's going to be a long road, so prayers that we get the correct answer.
Should keep you guys in our prayers. Anyone else this morning? Kathy's Bryce's dad took a fall last Sunday and broke his leg and has been in the hospital in Winfield, so keep John in our prayer. Ed?
We got word this morning that Charlie Prater passed away yesterday. Longtime manager of Walmart, retired, opened up a shoe store here in Chanute. His wife's maiden name was Sloan, Linda Sloan, so we'd like to pass that along.
Their family and prayers. Anyone else this morning? Okay, Marcia.
You know, with the two stories that were shared today, and with the choir song, and your story too, Jim, we just got to say, all God's people say,
amen.
And a little louder, please.
Amen.
Amen. Marsha, we need the Awana kids here to say that. Amen.
I know.
We need
a little bit more enthusiasm.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I do. I'm not sure which committee suggested that we go to the NCC basketball games, but last fall, we had four or five girls basketball players helping us with Awana. And Wednesday night, we had, I think, eight volleyball girls here and 15 soccer players, guys and gals, and they were awesome.
Now this is Dwight. We went out and saw our 13th grandchild get baptized at Church of Resurrection yesterday, so that was a blessing. And Church of Resurrection, of course, they built this brand new sanctuary. It's huge, and Adam was saying they're the biggest church in Kansas City. They're double the next one. And of course, the largest Methodist church in America. Anyway, he was telling the story, if you will. They had a physical examination for all their staff. Who knows how many that is. But the person doing the examination was a young lady, probably a nurse practitioner or something like that. He said, I was just talking with her and asking her about her faith. And she said, well, I'm Jewish. And it just so happens that he's going through a series on world religions. Last night was Buddhism. Next week is Judaism. So he said, he was talking to this young lady, and she said, I'd kind of like to come to hear what you have to say. And he said, well, that's great. We have Jewish people come all the time. And she said, I think I get this conversation. Has this happened to you? Has this ever happened to you before? He said, all the time.
Yeah. All right. Is there any other joys or concerns this morning?
We need to keep Mike Sutcliffe in our prayers as he gets ready to have more surgery. We also need to continue keeping Linda and her husband in our prayers as he still continues with struggling to get home. You're ready to have him home, aren't you, Linda? Any other? gracious God, we just come and we center ourselves in your holiness. We come and we seek comfort in where there's so much upheaval. We seek you in our lives. As we come together, some of us in grief and uncertainty, struggling with different health concerns, and living in the unknown, we come and we seek you, your presence to bring comfort and peace and understanding amidst it all. Between all of our concerns, though, we also come and we witness in our faith the joys of being shown you at work in our lives in the smallest and the most grandest of all ways. And to you, my God, we give
also still bringing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you'll be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they had heard the voice and saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple of Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias." He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight. And at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem, and here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name." The Lord said to him, "Go. For he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately, something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days, he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is the Son of God." This is the word of God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight. O Lord God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today we come to that wonderful conversion story of Saul to Paul. This might be one of the most important, one of them, events in the history of the church, other than the resurrection of Christ and Pentecost. Here we find Paul, and I'll kind of explain to you that who Saul at this time was. Saul was probably one of the harshest figures in the Bible against the movement of the way, which today would be considered Christianity. That was the name that they had gathered for themselves, and it was actually Saul himself who tore apart the way in Jerusalem. Saul felt it was his responsibility to crush this very dangerous movement that went against Moses. Against Moses. Now, I want to point out to you that Saul thought he was doing what was correct for God. He thought he was following the scriptures. He truly believed that he had to crush this in order for God's true way to be followed, that these others were in the wrong. So to him, putting to death women and men who were following Christ was the correct thing to do. He was consumed with one passion, to eradicate the followers of Jesus from earth. That's what it was about. So now he went on a 125-mile trek from Jerusalem to Damascus in order to do that. You see, Saul was consumed with heartless, quote, unquote, cruelty against the men and women, those who followed the movement called away. Now, I want to point out once again, Saul was zealous. He was zealous for the law of Moses. He thought he was doing the correct thing. But then on that way, when they got close to Damascus, a bright light from heaven flashed around them. They fell to the ground, not just Saul, but the others that was with him. And Saul himself, heard a voice saying, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul replied, who are you, Lord? Lord. And the actual word there implies Saul knew who this voice was from. The voice replied, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. The voice then told him what to do. And later, we know that Ananias, who only appears in Scripture a short time, but probably one of the most important figures in this conversion story, is told them what to do. And I can only imagine the fear that Ananias had. Here, he is being told to go to the most feared man on the planet towards the followers of the way, to go and help convert Saul. And Ananias does as he is told. Today, I want all of you to think about your own conversion. Think about if you are truly on the correct path that you are to be on. And I want you to compare what happened with Saul to where you are in your lives. And starting, salvation does not depend on the fallen will of man, but instead, salvation depends on the sovereign will and power of God. You see, Saul was one of the most wicked men on earth. He was murdering conviction of sin is a true mark of conversion. Before a man becomes a saint, he first must see himself as a sinner. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? The repetition of his name shows that God himself had tender concern for Saul. God wanted Saul to be transformed, to be converted. And then another true mark of conversion is being humble, being struck down from our pride. Pride is the root of all sins, and we must fight it each and every day. You see, Saul thought he was in the right. He thought he was doing what was good for God, and he had to have that struck down. He had to be able to see it for himself. But no, in his pride and his arrogance, he was wrong. And he had to turn a 180 and realize he was wrong. And then another true mark of conversion is obedience. Obedience. You see, Saul was told to get up and enter the city, and he would be then told what to do. Saul did not say, I'd like to accept you, Savior, but we're not quite ready to accept you quite yet, does my Lord. No, he got up and he went. And more than that, when the scales fell from his eyes and he truly saw the glory of Jesus and he was converted and transformed, Saul did everything that the Lord had wanted him to do. He became the rock. He became Paul. No matter the minute him being imprisoned, being tortured, and finally losing his life as he became a true follower of the way, he was obedient to the very end. And then another mark of true conversion is a transformation from spiritual blindness to spiritual sight. Paul began the trip of this holy seeing. He began his trip physically seeing, but he was spiritually blind. But he ended up being physically blind, but spiritually seeing. My son Andrew called it up here when I had the children close their eyes and tell me what they saw. Most of them said nothing. They Andrew said God. It was in Paul's true blindness that he finally was able to see Jesus in his life and be able to witness that he needed Jesus most, the one whom he was persecuting. And then another mark of conversion is prayer. Ananias was told to go and find this man, Saul, who was praying. I am sure that Saul prayed to God, the one whom he thought he was leading and following correctly. And now, through his blindness, he was truly praying to Jesus, praying to the one true God. And then the last mark of true conversion is fellowship. Have you noticed when Ananias went to visit, to gather up Paul, he says, Brother Saul. Brother. You see, he was brought into the full body of Christ. And it didn't stop. do we say, brother, come and join me and walk with me? I'll stand behind you even when others want to throw stones at you and persecute you for those wrongs you have done. Do we stand behind each other? Where are we in our conversion process? Do we pray? Do we fellowship? Do we see our sins? Are we obedient even when it means persecution or even death? Where are you? Paul's conversion is an example for all of us. His example of the fact that none of us are too far gone for God's mighty power to save. His example of what God can do when he takes hold of a life, of any life. His example to encourage us to pray for and share in the lives of every sinner, no matter how wicked. His example for us to commit ourselves afresh to whatever purpose God has given us to do for his kingdom. Where are you at? Let us pray. Almighty and glorious Lord, be with us. Help convict us of those things we are guilty of, and help us to fellowship with one another and to welcome everybody into our midst, no matter where they are in their lives. Help us to follow you and be obedient to you and to pray with you. Help us to turn a 180 and be a rock for your